Chapter 1 of The Romance of Mining, Jones. The Romance of Mining by Archibald Williams. Introductory. Any writer on mining in its general aspect is, when casting about for a starting point, driven to express what others have said before him: that the history of mining is the history of civilization. If we try to penetrate into the period when metals were unknown to, or at least unused by, man, all we find of his arts is a few rough scratches on a cavern wall and some stone implements of defense and offense. So we call the era, covering thousands, tens of thousands of years maybe, during which the cave dweller depended for his livelihood on his power of fashioning flints, the Stone Age. Synonymous, in our minds, with a dark, brutish existence of a creature just sufficiently more intelligent than the beasts of the field to survive their attacks and to live by destroying them. The ancients, who looked backwards rather than forwards in search of an ideal existence, spoke of the dawn of history as the Golden Age, the epithet being used metaphorically. All was then peace, plenty, and content. Strife between man and man, between nation and nation, had not yet arisen to mar human existence. Arguing from the social deterioration of their own time, they concluded that far back in the past, men must have been of a far nobler stamp, and their lot cast in much more pleasant surroundings. Today, we know too much to take refuge in such imaginations. While deploring the decay of time-honored institutions and the virtues of the good old times, we look confidently forward, and, were we given the choice, should not like to antedate our existence by even 100 years. From the vantage ground of knowledge, we see that mankind has steadily advanced in spite of temporary setbacks, fighting circumstances even more successfully by means of the weapons which the arts and sciences enable him to forge. The importance of metallurgy is shown by the very fact that, when we wish to divide human history into a few periods, we fly to the metals as the standards by which to measure man's industrial development. The Copper Age succeeds the Stone Age, then tin is found, and the Bronze Age begins. After the Bronze, the Iron Age, and, last of all, we have the Steel Age, in which we live. Though even at the present day there are, in different parts of the world, races still passing through the earlier ages. The metals serve three important ends. They supply man with the means of making life beautiful, secure, and comfortable. The first metal to be discovered was probably gold, which exists in its native or pure state in many countries, lies on the surface, attracts the eye, and can be easily secured. What nation first set value by gold, we cannot say, but we may reasonably conjecture that the primitive folk, even of the Stone Age, may have beaten this metal, valueless for tools or weapons, into decorations. So that, in one sense, the Golden Age was contemporaneous with the dawn of civilization. The value of gold arose only when other metals had been added to the list of those mined and worked. Copper, also found pure, though usually combined with other elements, must have been known to man at a very early date. By itself, its uses were limited, but when tin was discovered and alloyed with it, the manufacture of bronze altered the history of nations. The stone users were no match for invaders armed with bronze weapons tempered to extreme hardness. And where stone encountered metal, metal won. Civilization had now taken a long stride forwards. Bronze could be used for the arts of peace as well, being fashioned into tools, agricultural implements, ornaments, and money. So well did the alloy serve man that for long ages he was content with nothing harder and more stubborn. When the Spanish conquerors invaded Mexico in the 16th century, they found the Aztecs quite ignorant of the uses of iron, an ignorance which made possible the subjugation of a great race by a mere handful of bold adventurers. After bronze came lead, silver, quicksilver, and zinc. Silver was probably discovered at the same time as lead, since the two metals are often found together. This fact caused the alchemists of the Middle Ages to regard lead as the mother of silver, and to endeavour to transmute the baser into the more precious metal. Quicksilver, like lead and silver, is commonly found in combination with sulphur, which can be driven off by heat. And, whether discovered accidentally or otherwise, was used by the ancients as a solvent for gold. Who first forged iron must ever remain a mystery. Tubal-Cain is mentioned in the book of Genesis as, quote, an instructor of every artificer in brass and iron, end quote. He may have lived 3,000 years BC. The African natives seem to have been acquainted with the use of iron for time immemorial, perhaps long before the days when, in Greece, iron was offered as a prize to the victor in athletic games. The importance of iron, its utility for warlike as well as peaceful purposes, soon won it recognition. The early workers were defined under the names of Vulcan, Hephaestus, Thor. Legends cling round the ancient smithies, associating the pioneer craftsmen in iron with supernatural powers. Wayland Smith of the Berkshire Downs has left behind him, in the pages of Kenilworth, a reputation for magic. The family names of Smith, Smythe, Schmidt, Fabry, Lefebvre, and their equivalents in many other languages testify to the high rank of the armourer of the Middle Ages. The late employment of iron is partly accounted for by the circumstance that, though one of the most widely diffused minerals, it is never found pure except in the form of meteorites, lumps of iron which have suddenly descended upon the earth from the abysses of heaven. The earliest iron tools were probably made from these gifts of the gods, which have been found in various sizes ranging from a few ounces up to many tons. Iron ore is so little suggestive of the metal it contains that an inexperienced eye would never connect it with the iron and steel of commerce. And even when the relationship had been established by the ancients, the extraction of the metal from its matrix was a matter of great difficulty, on account of the numerous impurities of the ore and the high temperature needed for its reduction. We may still see in various parts of the world, China, Africa, the Malay Peninsula, the primitive methods used to separate the iron. A hearth blown by the winds, or a pump of the simplest form, and the beating on the anvil of a heated metal ball to squeeze out the impurities. Iron thus obtained was very valuable. Early warlike nations used it only for the business edge of their weapons, which were otherwise of copper or bronze. Just as bronze overcame stone, so iron vanquished bronze in battle. The Romans, and later the alchemists, called iron Mars. In the Bible, we read how the Philistines, after their conquest of the Israelites, carried off all the smiths. Quote, there was no smith found throughout all the land of Israel, for the Philistines said, lest the Hebrews make them swords and spears. But the Israelites went down to the Philistines to sharpen every man his share and his coulter and his axe and his mattock. End quote. Gibbon tells us that the Turks owed their position as a powerful invading nation to the iron which, as slaves, they fashioned for their lord, the great Khan of the Georgian. To quote his own words, quote, their servitude could only last till a leader, bold and eloquent, should arise, to persuade his countrymen that the same arms which they forged for their masters might become, in their own hands, the instruments of freedom and victory. They sallied from the mountains, AD 545. A scepter was the reward of his advice, and the annual ceremony, in which a piece of iron was heated in the fire, and a smith's hammer was successively handled by the prince and his nobles, recorded for ages the humble profession and rational pride of the Turkish nation. End quote. From that time onward, victory has declared for the nations who have known how to combine discipline and strategy with invention in the employment of iron. The Romans' short-stabbing sword and protected shield against the shieldless barbarian. The armor-clad Spaniard against the naked Mexican. The firearms of Europe against the spear, arrow, and club of savages. The armor-plated warship against the wooden walls. In every case, iron suitably fashioned wins the day. Even among highly civilized nations, every advantage of metallurgical science is eagerly seized to strengthen defenses and make weapons more deadly. Mere numbers do not now prevent defeat. Steel plates must be of the toughest. Cannon and rifles must belch out the greatest possible number of missiles with the greatest possible accuracy. The mechanism of war must be reliable in every way. As Monsieur Simonin wrote some decades ago, quote, "In the contests which will unhappily long continue to take place, victory will henceforth generally remain with those who produce steel in the largest quantity and of the finest quality." End quote. Words which were echoed by Mr. Andrew Carnegie when he said that predominance must be in the hands of the nation which can manufacture the cheapest ton of steel. Our age, the Steel Age, could not be better named. Whichever way we look, steel confronts us. We move over it, shaped as rails or bridges. It enters more and more into the construction of our houses. The machinery which transports us from place to place, clothes us, feeds us, caters for our luxuries, is wrought from steel. And the wealth of nations is derived chiefly from steel, either directly or indirectly. Hand in hand with steel advances coal, without which it would be impossible to make full use of the metal. Steam power waits on both. In fact, the triumvirate of steel, coal, and steam mutually support one another. Steam raises coal. Coal smelts iron ore. Iron ore yields material for the steam engine, and so round the circle again. So great is the part played by coal in modern civilization that the bottled sunshine of past ages may claim almost equally with steel to give a name to the present period in the history of mankind. Enormous as has been the effect of iron on the fortunes of human society, we cannot forget the importance of the intrinsically more precious metals. Their unalterability, their beauty, and their variety have won them a place in our regard which, so far as we can see, nothing will ever be able to diminish. Associated as silver and gold have been with princely magnificence, they appeal to our aesthetic sense. The figures which stand out from history often, in part at least, owe their fame to the glamour of great wealth. What more striking personage has been immortalized by Holy Writ than King Solomon, in whose days silver was nothing accounted of, whose palaces and thrones were decked with gold, whose argosies sailed home laden with the gold of Ophir? The precious stones and marvellous riches which loom so largely in the Arabian Nights contribute, as much as personal adventure, to the fascination of that book. Gold has been the magnet that has attracted the conqueror and the explorer. Time after time, India, the land of gold and diamonds, has had to bow to the invader, informed through travellers' tales of the wealth of the country. Gold took the Spaniards to Mexico and Peru. Gold drew hundreds of thousands to California, Australia, South Africa, Alaska. Unfurl the golden standard where you will. A huge army soon collects under the banner and, after exhausting the minerals, turns to the agricultural development of the country. But for the reputed riches of Ormuz and of Ind, exploration and colonization of the world by Europeans would have been delayed for centuries. The advance of science has been so greatly stimulated by metallurgy, and in turn metallurgy owes so much to scientific discovery, that we can hardly conceive of the one without the other. The alchemy of the Middle Ages, which vainly strove to change the baser into the nobler metals, laid the foundations for modern chemistry, which helps, on the one hand, to trace and extract metal from its ore, and on the other, shows how metal may serve mankind in a thousand ways. The influence of mining on mechanical arts is no less striking. Out of the ladder and bucket has gradually been evolved the winding engine which whirls men and ore at 20 miles an hour from the depths of the earth. The air or water-driven drill has replaced the stone or bronze hammer of the ancient miner. Electric lamps have ousted, in large degree, the candle and flickering oil boat. Tramways do with ease what once caused bucket-carrying men much toil and pain. The mechanical coal cutter does the work of 100 picks. Dynamite blasts into fragments huge masses that formerly would have been cleft laboriously with wedges. In spite of his conservatism, the miner finally adapts to his use any invention which has proved beneficial to those who work on the earth's surface. And in return, he has shown how mountains may be burrowed through for the passage of the locomotive. The Simplon Tunnel and the prehistoric underground galleries of Italy and Spain are more closely related than one may think. To those who can see romance in industry, what a field does mining open? The story of the metals is bound up with phenomenal individual success and equally gigantic failures. In a day, the pauper becomes a prince, and he who fancied himself a prince finds himself a pauper. A humanity which takes pleasure in risking wealth on the cast of dice, on the running of a horse, or on the quotations of the stock exchange, cannot be but enthralled by the sudden ups and downs inseparable from the exploitation of new mines and virgin countries. Who has not, at one time or another, felt the desire to take pick and shovel and go on the trail of the miner in the hope that he may prove a Marshall, a Hargraves, a Godoy, a Gould, or a Drake? From every corner of the globe come sensational, and often true, stories of men who, in a lucky moment, have grasped a secret worth millions of pounds. The world is large, and for every fortune that has been made, 100 still remain for the prospector. Even when wealth has to be won by continuous and quite everyday work at the point of drill and pick, the conditions of life are such as to appeal to the imagination. The great brotherhood of miners, the sturdy Cornishman, the lithe Italian, the stubborn, superstitious German, the hardy, sombreroed Asturian, the Chilean baratero, calm and impassive, the excitable Frenchman, the thrifty, patient Chinaman, is surrounded by perils and hardships. It was not without reason that the miners of the Harz peopled their mines with malicious gnomes, and prayed to Saints Nickel and Cobbold before descending into the depths. Fire, water, poisonous gases, falling roofs, breaking ropes and ladders are the terrors which the miner faces without thought as part and parcel of the risks of his calling. Yet for the outsider, the bravery and resource shown by the toilers of the deepest deep in the presence of disaster help to weave a romance as real as that of the battlefield. And that, in spite of its hardships, mining has a fascination for the worker, is proved by the unwillingness of a miner to relinquish his calling in favour of any other. The following pages, while touching the chief branches of the mining industry, must necessarily omit reference to many of the great treasure houses of the world. Special prominence has been given to the precious metals because their discovery and working has witnessed the most stirring scenes in mining life. As Mr. Fawcett writes in his Colorado, quote, "There has been a fascination and romance attending the search of the precious metals, and time intensifies rather than diminishes the feeling. Under the magic influence of gold and silver discoveries, a spirit of enterprise has been engendered that has brought about the accomplishment of results as unexpected as they were grand and wonderful. The wilderness is peopled, states are founded, and almost an empire established where the presence of civilized man was unknown but a few years ago." End quote. The reader will also be glad to hear of the source and supply of some of the most valuable varieties of jewels, round which romance clings even more abundantly than round the metals, since individual stones have had their histories. We have the whole world to roam over, so excursions are made into those spots where typical or prominent instances of the mining of various minerals are to be found. Mining, here used in its widest sense, includes operations on the surface as well as those underground, and extends to those substances which are extracted from the earth without recourse to shafts and tunnels. Enter a jeweler's shop and take note of the minerals ranged around. Could they speak, what stories they might have to tell. There is the gold of many countries, the silver of Mexico, Nevada, Spain, Bolivia, Mexico, the tin of Cornwall and Malacca, the copper of Lake Superior, the platinum of Colombia or the Ural Mountains, the diamond of Brazil and Griqualand, the ruby of Burma, the turquoise of Persia, the emerald of Peru, the sapphire of Ceylon. Even in an ironmonger's, the metal displayed hails from many lands. The British Isles, France, the United States, Germany, Austria, Russia, Sweden, Italy, Spain, and Siberia. In the stonemason's yard, English sandstone jostles Italian marble and Scotch granite and Welsh slate. On the grocer's shelves, English salt stands close to Sicilian sulphur. Let us go and see how these diverse substances were discovered, how they are won to the use of mankind, how the people live who exhume them, and what are and have been the difficulties encountered before nature's mineral riches are poured by land and sea into the lap of civilization. End of chapter 1.
Chapter 2 with the Romance of Mining. The Romance of Mining by Archibald Williams. Ancient Mining. Features of Early Mining. Riches of the Ancients. The Egyptian Mines. The Earliest European Miner. The Etruscan Mines of Campaglia. The Phoenicians. Zimbabwe. The Romans as Miners. The Romans in Britain. Aztecs and Peruvians, the development of mining methods, ventilation, gunpowder, hoisting devices, comparative comfort of modern miners. Before embarking on detailed accounts of the various branches of mining as conducted today, we shall do well to consider briefly the earliest stages of the industry, when it was being gradually evolved and organized by the old and great peoples of the earth. Three facts seem to stand out clearly in respect of ancient mining. One, that India was the center, at least in the old world, from which radiated the first advances in the science of extracting minerals, to pass successively through Egypt, Phoenicia, and the archipelago, to Greece and Italy, whence they penetrated to Germany, Gaul, and the British Isles. Two, that among the ancients, mining was not considered honorable toil, and therefore had to be performed by slaves. Hence, a nation had to become a conqueror before it could set up as a mine owner. 3. That gold was the metal to which the earliest miners turned their serious attention, copper mining second, and tin third. As we have already noticed, iron made an appearance very late, when metallurgy had developed so far that the Egyptians and other races were able to perform many operations with bronze tools, which, for lack of knowledge, how to temper the copper alloy to a requisite hardness, we could not imitate today without recourse to steel. We may safely assume that mining was practiced in Eastern countries for 3 or 4 thousand years before the Christian era. Gold, won from the earth by washing alluvial deposits, just as is still done in many localities, steadily accumulated in the royal coffers of a kingdom until, in order to put it to some practical use, it was fashioned into objects of worship or the paraphernalia of a court. In Babylon, there were 3 great statues of beaten gold, 2 of them 40 feet high, and the 3rd probably of similar dimensions, though sitting. Besides these, there was an altar, 40 feet long and 15 feet broad, covered with gold plates and several massive bowls and censers. From the weights given, it has been calculated that the raw metal in these constructions weighed about 2,700,000 ounces, or about 11 million pounds. We know, too, that Darius was able to wring a yearly tribute of over 2,500,000 pounds out of his satrapies. David and Solomon devoted huge quantities of the metal to the adornment of the temple and the royal palace. The Athenians reared over their citadel an enormous gold and ivory statue of the goddess Athene. In the New World, the same accumulation went on through the ages, there being no gold currency to absorb the gold, so that the Spanish conquerors on their arrival in Mexico and Peru found vast treasure worth a desperate struggle for its ownership. It must not be supposed that the old world as a whole, or even contiguous countries, kept abreast in the art of mining. As we can see at the present time, some races have retained the most primitive processes, while others have advanced. The Chinaman of the interior of China extracts his iron from its ore in the same way as his ancestors did before him for countless generations. The rock drill and ponderous ore-crushing stamp exist contemporaneously with the stone hatchet. Therefore, in speaking of ancient mining, we should remember that its development was local and spasmodic, though the general tendency throughout the world was forwards. We naturally look to the Egyptians for the earliest mining work that can be even approximately dated. The copper mines of Sinai are the most ancient of which history makes mention. According to documentary accounts, they were worked from 5000 BC to about 1200 BC. There still exist the tunnels, furnaces, crucibles, and parts of the tools used by these toilers of the dim past. That the Egyptians knew of iron thousands of years ago is suggested by sculptures of what are supposed to be iron smelting furnaces. But as these particular sculptures do not date further back than 1500 BC, the introduction of iron would, even if the treatment of that metal is indicated, still be very greatly posterior to the mining of copper. And we are left to wonder how the Egyptians carved the great granite blocks that now attract tourists in crowds to the valley of the Nile. The earliest European workings may have been the Spanish. Among the copper lodes of the Asturias, human skulls of a prehistoric type have been discovered near mining implements of flint. When metallurgy was dawning in the Italian peninsula, the old Etruscans drove galleries through the rocks of Campiglia in search of copper. There are, says Monsieur Simonin, in Underground Life, excavations large enough to hold a 6-storied house with ease. These vast chambers communicate with each other by means of narrow galleries, or rather passages, in which a person could scarcely crawl. The barren rocks, left as rubbish or waste in the excavations, have hardened and become cemented together under the pressure of the overlying beds and by the earthy debris of the mine. These artificial masses can only be broken by blasting, like those blocks of concrete which are thrown into the sea in the construction of breakwaters. The wooden props are still in place, rotted, or rather carbonized, by a sort of slow decomposition of the vegetable tissue. All the smell they give out may be recognized as that of the evergreen oak and the chestnut, which are always grown in the country. Fragments of vases, lamps, and amphorae, which are found in the rubbish, are connected with Etruscan art. Wedges and bronze picks have also been met with in the mines, affording proofs that these works date from a period when iron was not commonly used for ordinary purposes. Enormous masses of rubbish cover the flanks of the mountains where the ancient pits have been opened, and over an extent of several miles follow two parallel courses marking the outcrops of the veins. In the valleys there are still enormous heaps of cinders on the very sites of the ancient foundries. Though these mines have not been worked for possibly 3,000 years, they show a comparatively advanced stage of mining art. The very marks of the tools still remain in the rock, as fresh as if they had been made yesterday. The Phoenicians played so important a part in the spread of civilization through the Mediterranean countries and even beyond the Pillars of Hercules, as the ancients turned the Straits of Gibraltar, by trading and exploiting the mineral deposits known to them, that we may pay special attention to their operations. Before the Phoenicians first visited Spain, the inhabitants had worked the silver, lead, and copper mines of Huelva, Cordova, Seville, and Malaga, in the southern parts of the peninsula. The Canaanitish traders, getting access to the coast direct and to the inland regions, generally called Tarshish, by the Guadalquivir, drove a profitable trade with the natives in the metals mentioned. As soon as they had established themselves firmly, they either compelled the natives to work the mines for them, or imported slaves from their own territories bordering the Mediterranean. They must have obtained huge quantities of metal, if Diodorus of Sicily is not exaggerating when he states that even the anchors of ships returning from Spain were of silver, a statement which reminds us of the silver cannon sent by Pizarro from Peru to Spain. The historian says further that the avarice of the Carthaginians, Phoenicians, led them to seek for and work mines in all parts of the peninsula, and that it was from this source they obtained the means with which to combat and for a long period stubbornly resist the ultimately superior forces of mighty Rome. It is, unfortunately, impossible to distinguish the Phoenician from the Roman operations which immediately succeeded them. But we may be sure that many thousand tons of copper, tin, and silver were extracted during the Punic occupation, the zenith of their activity probably being the period when Solomon sent his ships to Tarshish. Naturally adventurous voyages, the Phoenicians coasted around the Atlantic shores of Spain and France, and finally reached the westernmost part of England, where they did a brisk trade in tin with the savage Cornishmen. We shall refer to this sphere of their activity more fully in a later chapter. In Rhodesia, at Zimbabwe, are ancient ruins of great extent, and old mines from which large quantities of gold were extracted by the people that raised the huge fortress there. Legend has long associated this region with the Ophir of King Solomon, and Mr. Ryder Haggard, in his King Solomon's Mines, has drawn an imaginative picture of the excavations driven through the mountains in the time of that monarch. More recently, fact has succeeded fiction. Mr. Theodore Bent, after a careful examination of Zimbabwe and its surroundings, pronounced that during one period of its earliest history, the Phoenicians occupied Rhodesia, and that to them are largely due the galleries and pits, which can be counted by the thousands all over the country. The gold was not merely won from the outcrops of veins. shafts were sunk to a depth of even 150 feet, and levels were driven from there along the veins. The Rhodesian miners also knew the use of fire to crack and splinter the rock before attacking it with tools. They brought up the quartz, ground it in mills, and washed the particles of gold out of the rubbish and hollows still visible along the riverbed. Bent found rows of crushing stones and water holes at which the African slaves wore out their miserable lives. The gold thus obtained was smelted and cast in soapstone molds for conveyance to the coast, whence it probably went by sea to the Red Sea and overland to Palestine. When at last the Phoenicians had to quit their South African colony, they walled up the entrances to some of the mines before they went. Outside others, heaps of quartz stand stacked ready for removal. Tools are found at the bottom of shafts, as if abandoned by the workers in a panic. Curious flint tools, stone axes and wedges, as well as very ancient iron chisels, hammers, wedges, and trowels. The quartz crushers are thrown down near their basins. A pile of skeletons at the Mundi ruins gives evidence of a flight or massacre. Cakes of gold lying by their waist may once have been held in a belt. In Europe, the Romans took up the Phoenician workings after the destruction of Carthage. During their occupation of Spain, from 210 BC to about 425 AD, they busied themselves with the mining of gold, silver, and copper. Spain became the Roman Siberia, to which slaves were sent by thousands to end their days in the mines. Polybius says that 40,000 men worked the mines of New Carthage alone. From Pliny and Titus Livius, we learn that 20,000 pounds worth of gold came annually from the Iberian Peninsula. Little is said of the copper workings, though these, especially in the Rio Tinto districts, must have been enormous. The heaps of slag and cinders which, near the Rio Tinto and Tharsis mines, almost rise to the dignity of hills, have been calculated to contain upwards of 30 million tons of ore and rubbish. Gonzalo Taran, a Spanish expert, estimates that it took the labor of 10,000 slaves working for 45,000 days to amass this huge quantity of dump, and that during the Roman occupation, over 10 million tons of copper were extracted from 12 vent mines. The Romans drove miles of tunnels through the hills and hollowed out great chambers in the ore body. Their mining skill is suggested by the water wheels and other devices found in the underground workings, and by the remarkable regularity of the excavations. When Julius Caesar invaded England in the year 55 BC, he wrote, "They, the Britons, use brass money and iron rings of a certain weight. The provinces remote from the sea produce tin, and those upon the coast iron, but the latter in no great quantity. Their brass is imported." After their experience of Spanish mines, the Romans were encouraged to seek mineral treasures in Ultima Thule. They have left traces of their activity in many parts of the kingdom. In Cornwall, they extracted tin. In Northumberland, Derbyshire, Yorkshire, Cheshire, Nottinghamshire, Shropshire, the Wye Valley, and the Forest of Dean, they mined lead. Pliny, in referring to this metal, says, "It is extracted with a great labor in Spain and throughout the Gallic provinces, but in Britannia it is found in the upper stratum of the earth in such abundance that a law has been spontaneously made, prohibiting anyone from working more than a certain quantity of it." The Mendip Hills, Somersetshire, are pitted with Roman lead mines. The slag left by the Romans has been re-smelted in recent years and has yielded large quantities of metal. Copper was raised near Oswestry, gold in Carmarthenshire, iron in several counties. Rude furnitures and masses of iron slag have been found overgrown by peat or buried beneath accumulations of soil. Roman mining in Britain reached a fairly high standard of excellence. In Cornwall, there still exists an adit, or tunnel, driven from the bottom of a hill into a lode to drain off the water. The work is distinguished by the symmetry of the arch and the careful masonry of the stones which line it. Passing to the New World, we find but few traces of distinctly ancient mining. Until the coming of Europeans, the methods of extracting ore were mostly very primitive in both North and South America. In the copper districts of Lake Superior, the aborigines used only stone hammers and perhaps bags of hide to remove the metal, hacked off the great lumps of it which here and there showed above the surface. In Central America, tombs have been opened containing stone chisels, awls, and polishers, with which the old inhabitants of Panama attacked the gold placers or surface deposits ages before the arrival of the Spaniards. The Aztecs of Mexico and the Peruvians had considerable knowledge of mining, though ignorant of the uses of iron. With bronze tools, they burrowed into the hills and took out gold, silver, tin, and copper in large quantities. Of the Peruvian methods, Prescott writes, they did not attempt to penetrate into the bowels of the earth by sinking a shaft, but simply excavated a cavern in the steep sides of the mountain, or, at most, opened a horizontal vein of moderate depth. They were equally deficient in the knowledge of the best means of detaching the precious metal from the dross with which it was united, and had no idea of the virtues of quicksilver, a mineral not rare in Peru, as an amalgam to effect this decomposition. Their method of smelting the ore was by means of furnaces built in elevated and exposed situations, where they might be fanned by the strong breezes of the mountains. The subjects of the Incas, in short, with all their patient perseverance, did little more than penetrate below the crust, the outer rind, as it were, formed over those golden caverns which lie hidden in the dark depths of the Andes. Both nations managed, however, to amass much treasure for their rulers. When Cortes divided the spoils of Mexico, he had to deal with gold and silver plate worth 1,417,000 pounds, while Pizarro in Peru melted down 3.5 million pounds worth. It is probable that the treasure captured was but a fraction of the total, since the vanquished would have hidden many of their precious possessions as soon as they found what the Spaniards came for. Under the conquerors, European methods increased the yield of the mines so greatly that Spain took the foremost place among the nations of the 16th century in wealth and power. The science of mining has advanced gradually with the increase of mechanical knowledge, until the invention of gunpowder, and in many places for a long time afterwards, the shafts and levels were driven entirely by means of picks and wedges. The labor must have been infinitely more tedious and painful than it is today, when, in spite of all our modern appliances, a miner's life is one of the hardest possible. As Dr. John A. Church has said, the old mines were horrible working places. The galleries were low, torturous, so poorly supported that accidents by caving of the roof were probably frequent. They were lighted by pine knots or by lamps made only of a clay saucer filled with ill-smelling vegetable oil or tallow, in which a bit of rush, pith or rag, floating, served for wick, and they were without ventilation to carry off the dense smoke from these lamps and the effluvia arising from severe labor. Even after centuries of experience, when mining had become a great industry, the condition of the mines was deplorable. One of the greatest hardships was the want of a current of fresh air to reduce the heat of the galleries and provide pure oxygen for the workers' lungs. In the 16th century, rough ventilating fans were constructed, the vanes sometimes edged with feathers to create a draft in the galleries. About the same time, pumps were installed to free mines of water, a task previously only possible, and that on a very limited scale, by the raising of buckets with windlasses or on men's backs. We may suppose that gunpowder was not used below ground until methods of ventilation were fairly perfect, since its poisonous fumes would have rendered stagnant air quite unbreathable for a long time after an explosion. The latter still survives in many mines as the sole means of descent and ascent, involving an immense amount of extra fatigue. Steam power only was able to give quick transit, first in the man engine, such as still used in Cornwall, and afterwards in the rope-hoisted cage. Steam was also harnessed to ventilating and pumping machinery, and later to that for lighting. But for explosives and steam, modern deep mining would have been absolutely impossible. Man now sinks shafts 5,000 feet down into the earth, and from the bottom burrows horizontally. He sends copious currents of air to the lowest depths, pumps out the water if need be, and leads compressed air and electricity through a maze of pipes and wires to work machine drills which, in combination with high explosives, relieve the miner of a large part of the toil otherwise necessary to secure the minerals. As we shall read in future pages, the underground workers of today have hardships and perils to encounter, but in comparison with the surroundings of those who first explored the deep treasure houses of nature, theirs is a comfortable and happy lot. End of chapter 2. Chapter 3 of The Romance of Mining. The Romance of Mining by Archibald Williams. The El Dorado of the Great West. The Sierra Nevada. The result of altering a mill race. First discovery of gold in California. Booty scented by the public. Gold reaches San Francisco. Sudden rise in wages. Scenes in Frisco. Off to the diggings. The Mormons, the mining outfit, scarcity of water, disappointed hopes, placer mining, panning out, the sluice, racial feeling, hardships and disease, riotous extravagance, what the average miner got, rough justice, danger of wealth, incredible selfishness, trouble in San Francisco, the transcontinental journey, what Mark Twain saw. Rapid increase in California's population. The miners' restlessness. The sad results. Exhaustion of placers. Hydraulic mining. Gigantic flumes. How gold is washed out by the hydraulic jet. Devastating effect on the country. Parallel to the coast of Upper California, at a distance inland of about 200 miles, runs the Sierra Nevada, a continuous and lofty range marked by a line of dominant peaks, many of which are over 14,000 feet high. It has an average width of about 80 miles, and its western slopes are more gentle than the eastern, which abound in precipitous declines. From the mountains, many streams hurry westwards to join a main river called the Sacramento, flowing into the San Francisco Bay. On their way, these tributaries cut through mighty deposits of gravel, which in the course of the ages have been detached from the heights and distributed along the valleys. From the latitude of San Francisco north to Oregon, the strata of the range have received a liberal salting with gold at the hands of nature, and the water has separated huge quantities of it from its bed, to strew it in the river courses and in gulches through which streams no longer flow. This huge auriferous belt on the Sierra's western slope is the El Dorado of the West. One January day in 1848, a Mr. Marshall was making alterations at his sawmill on the Americanos River, which enters the Sacramento at a point where the town of the same name now rises. The tail race of the mill, being too narrow to allow the water to run off in sufficient quantities to get full work out of the wheel, he threw the mill wheel out of gear and suddenly let the whole body of water behind the dam loose into the race. This operation considerably enlarged the narrow channel, and a mass of sand and gravel was carried off by the force of the current. Captain Sutter, a neighbor, thus related what followed to Dr. J. Tyrwhitt Brooks, one of the pioneer miners. Early in the morning after this took place, he was walking along the left bank of the stream when he perceived something which he at first took for a piece of opal, a clear, transparent stone, very common there, glittering on one of the spots laid bare by the sudden crumbling of the bank. He paid no attention to it. But while he was giving directions to the workman, having observed several similar glittering fragments, his curiosity was so far excited that he stooped down and picked up one of them. "Do you know," said Mr. Marshall to me, "I positively debated with myself 2 or 3 times whether I should take the trouble to bend my back to pick up one of the pieces, and had decided on not doing so, when further on, another glittering morsel caught my eye, the largest of the pieces now before you. I condescended to pick it up, and to my astonishment, found that it was a thin scale of what appears to be pure gold." He then gathered some 20 or 30 similar pieces, which, on examination, convinced him that his suppositions were right. His first impression was that this gold had been lost or buried there by some early Indian tribe, perhaps some of these mysterious inhabitants of the West, of whom we have no account, but who dwelt on this continent centuries ago, and built those cities and temples, the ruins of which are scattered about these solitary wilds. On proceeding, however, to examine the neighboring soil, he discovered that it was more or less auriferous. This at once decided him. He mounted his horse and rode down to me as fast as it would carry him with the news. Captain Sutter was soon convinced that the specimen shown that an epoch in California history had been opened. Of course, the first thing for the two lucky men to do was to keep the discovery to themselves. They visited the mill and poked about among the sand with such good results that they soon had collected 1 ounce of the precious metal. The next day they went further up the stream and found that gold existed along the whole course, not only in the bed of the main stream, but also in the now dried-up gulches and creeks leading into it. Indeed, gold appeared most plentiful in the ravines. The Captain Sutter picked out a dry gorge with his knife, a lump of solid gold, scaling nearly 1.5 ounces. Unfortunately for the discoverer and his friends, the mill workpeople had sent in Booty, a Kentuckian, suspecting that something was up, dogged the prospectors about and searched for the object of their wanderings, so that when they returned to the mill, they were astonished, not to say disgusted, by the laborers running up with flakes of gold, which an Indian, who had previously worked in a mine in Lower California, had immediately recognized as the true stuff. The secret had thus become public property in a very few hours. Such a piece of news soon spread, and hard on its heels came actual proof of its truth in the shape of gold flakes sent down to San Francisco. On May 8th, a man entered the town with 23 ounces of gold. People at once began with one voice to talk of nothing but the new placers, a Spanish term signifying spots where gold is found mixed with alluvial deposit. Parties were formed at once to visit the diggings, and individuals started off alone with shovels, mattocks, and pans to dig the metal out. The talk soon bred a perfect furor. All the workpeople struck. Out of 50 new buildings in course of construction, only about 6 would not be reft of artisans, the majority of whom, together with lawyers, storekeepers, and merchants, were bitten by the fever. On many a door could be seen a paper bearing the legend, "Gone to the diggings." Wages increased by leaps and bounds. The people who remained behind could ask their own terms. Salesmen and shopmen got $2,300 to $2,700 a year, with board, and even boys received salaries which in the pre-mania days would have satisfied the heads of large departments. But while many houses were being deserted, fresh inhabitants poured in by sea, many having come across the Isthmus of Panama to a point where they could take ship. Up sprang a host of canvas booths to accommodate the newcomers. In the better parts of the town, stupendous taverns, gambling houses, and other buildings commanded huge rents, anything up to $100,000 a year. "Skirting the beach," writes an eyewitness, was a vast collection of tents called the Happy Valley, since more truly designated the Sickly Valley, with filth of every description and stagnant pools beset one at every stride. In these tents congregated the refuse of all nations, crowded together, 8 people occupying what was only space for 2. Blankets, firearms, and cooking utensils were the only worldly property they possessed. Scenes of depravity, sickness, and wretchedness shocked the moral sense, as much as filth and effluvia did the nerves, and such was the state of personal insecurity the few citizens slept without firearms at hand. The constant wearing of arms by such a disorderly set, amongst whom quarrels were frequent, caused many disputes to terminate disastrously. But the unsettled state of the country and the many desperate characters prowling about made it necessary to be armed for self-protection. The weaker party was only sheltered from oppression by a loaded revolver, as there was no assistance to be expected from others. Steel and lead were the only arguments available for redress, and bystanders looked on unconcernedly at acts of violence, the cause of the dispute or the justice of the punishment inflicted being seldom inquired into. A poor man arriving in San Francisco had small chance of comfort. Even if he possessed a fairly heavy purse, it soon lost its weight in a city where a good meal cost $3. Even if the owner kept clear of the many gambling hells which kept open house for the allurement of the greenhorns. In the 50s, San Francisco was very inaccessible as compared with its position today at the termini of several great transcontinental lines. To get thither from the East Coast, the traveler had a choice between a tedious sea journey round the Horn, a partly sea and partly land route via the Panama Isthmus, across which a road and subsequently a railway were driven, and a land march of some 3,000 miles. Nevertheless, the distant sea era soon teemed with a population of many thousands. Most of the immigrants, at least during the first 2 years, came in from the coast, while a minority worked across the trackless plains, braving the hostility of the Indians and the many physical difficulties of a passage through a waterless, trackless, and arid region. Many a bloody battle was fought between the white gold seeker and the scalp-loving Crow, Pawnee, or Sioux. Though the lighter color eventually prevailed, the natives, when skilled in the arts of treachery and ambuscade, often murdered parties of their natural foes, and escaped with their gory trophies into the fastnesses of the mountains. Shortly after the discovery of gold, a large emigrant band of Mormons entered California across the Rockies. Without wasting time, they made straight for the Americanos River and began washing out the golden flakes and dust which permeated the bed of the stream. They did not have the valley to themselves for long, since the miners from San Francisco were now on the march to the Mormon diggings, as they were called after the first comers. The miners leaving San Francisco for the gold fields often banded together for mutual protection and help. The perils of the journey were such as to render the passage of a solitary person a terribly risky business. Before starting, the more prudent gold seekers equipped themselves with an outfit, viz., tent, spades, mattocks, axe, blankets, hides, coffee, sugar, whiskey, brandy, knives, plates, forks, pots, and kettles. If funds permitted, a horse or two would be added to the list as beasts of burden, and anyone who could afford it purchased a mount for his personal use. But some days the track up country lay through an undulating, park-like region, with sycamore, oak, and cypress offered grateful shelter from the burning sun. Then the landscape changed, and bare sandhills replaced the green vegetation. Horrible dust storms filled the eyes and mouths of the travelers. Hot winds parched their skin till it cracked, and to these discomforts were added the pangs of thirst. On one occasion, a party met a straggler who offered them a flask of brandy, priceless at the diggings, in exchange for just a half a pint of water. The party was refused, because water was excessively scarce among the party, and the poor wretch learnt that the necessaries of life are after all superior to its luxuries. Here and there they fell in with men returning from the mines, broken in hope and health, who prophesied ruin to anyone who entered the diggings, and advised a retreat before it was too late. Such advice, as may be imagined, was quite unheeded, for the prospect of finding gold appeared to blind everybody who had not yet tried his luck at the game to all considerations of possible physical collapse. Travelers had to reckon with the Indians, ever on the alert to steal a horse or any other possession of the white invader. At night, watches were set, and if the guard, overcome by the fatigues of the day, nodded at their post, an animal or two would probably be missing when daylight returned. The strains of such a journey often let loose evil passions, and men who had started from San Francisco, bound together by solemn pledges to stick to one another, would quarrel and separate, each endeavoring to be first at the diggings. But the roughest path has an end, and at last weary eyes were gladdened by the sight of tents lining the banks of a stream. A canvas erection of unusual size indicated a store, where Indians, Oregon trappers, with skin tanned to the consistency of a buffalo's, Spanish dons of the old school, hatchet-faced Yankees, keen-eyed as the eagle, jostled one another as they exchanged their gold dust for food and tools. We may now turn our attention to the gold-saving methods employed at the Californian places. At first, operations were confined almost entirely to the shallow or surface diggings, where the gold lay at or just below the surface. Not until the superficial strata was pretty well played out, was serious attention paid to the deeper placers, which could be worked only through long tunnels and shafts. The principal implements used for shallow working are the pick and shovel, pan, cradle or rocker, and the sluice. The pan, about 12 inches in diameter at the bottom, is of stamped iron and much resembles the ordinary dairy milk pan. To extract gold from the earth with which it mingles, the pan is filled with the dirt and taken into the water, a stream, tub, or pool, as the case may be. It is submerged, and the miner works the dirt with his hands until the lumps have crumbled. Then, holding one side of the pan rather higher than the other, he gives it a peculiar circular motion, which produces a rotary current and causes the lighter portion to pass over the lip, the heavier particles remaining behind. The earthy element is thus gradually eliminated, and the pebbles are picked out by hand, until only a small residue remains, which is either pure gold or gold mixed with a small quantity of sand. The residue is then carefully dried in an iron vessel, and the earthy dust can be blown away, leaving nothing but pure gold. Panning is slow and laborious work, so that those who had money or skill sufficient to provide themselves with a rocker, or gold canoe, as the Indians styled it, resorted to this less primitive method of washing. The rocker resembles a child's cradle. About 6 inches from the top is a drawer, with a bottom of perforated iron. Earth is thrown by one man into the drawer, and well flooded with water to break up the lumps. A second miner rocks the cradle backwards and forwards till the finer contents of the drawer fall through the sloping tray below, on which are crossbars, called riffles, to arrest the gold. Much more scientific than either of these simple contrivances is the sluice, a long, slightly inclined trough through which water flows rapidly. Its dimensions vary according to circumstances. In some cases, only a single trough, 10 to 12 inches deep, 15 to 20 wide, and 12 feet long, would be used. But as each trough tapers towards its lower end, any number can easily be fitted one into the other to form a continuous sluice thousands of feet in length. The trough bottom is well provided with riffles, sometimes charged with mercury to catch the particles of gold. The more mercury being needed, the finer the separation of the metal dust. Sluice washing is, if possible, carried on without interruption day and night, for weeks, even for months. Then comes the cleanup. The gold, either free or amalgamated with the mercury, is carefully scraped from the riffles and washed clean in a pan. Amalgam has to be squeezed in buckskin or canvas, which allows the liquid mercury to pass, but retains the solid amalgam. This is put into a retort and subjected to great heat until all the mercury has vaporized and been led into a condenser, where it resumes its liquid form. The gold thus obtained is very porous or spongy and must be melted down and run into bars to be fit for sale. In 49 and 50, the rocker and pan did most of the work. The toil was severe in the case of the pan, which required constant stooping, while the constant immersion of the hands rapidly macerated the skin and made them very painful. The rocker saved the hands this injury, and by employing several sets of muscles, enabled the miner to keep on working without much physical discomfort. By a rule of the diggings, when a party operated a cradle, a nugget weighing over half an ounce was considered to be the private property of the person who found it and was not added to the common fund of metal. Since several nationalities occupied the diggings, race feeling became acute. The Americans, who predominated numerically, showed their teeth to the colored miners, and if their property were worth the trouble, often drove them away. These ejectments sometimes resulted in serious fighting, as the injured party was always ready to resort to stealthy retaliation under cover of night. Nor was there much love lost between the white gangs. At the Mormon diggings, a quarrel broke out over a sluice which damaged the claims lower down the valley. The sluice owners refused compensation to the injured diggers, who, accordingly, raided the aggressors. Knives, picks, rifles, and pistols were freely used. Heads were smashed in, limbs lopped, bullets flew, and in a few minutes the ground had all the appearance of a miniature battlefield. No truthful picture of these early camps can, unfortunately, be a pleasant one. Even in the hot season, the nightly dews were so heavy that blankets would be saturated by the morning. In the rainy season, a deluge fell, against which the frail erections of earth and canvas afforded little shelter. Owing to exposure, hard work, and poor food, disease stalked in many shapes among the miners. The most prevalent complaints were dysentery, fever, and ague, for which little help could be procured, since the few doctors present charged exorbitant fees, and medicine was practically non-existent. Every now and then, a poor wretch, mad in the delirium of fever, would rush frantically from his tent and attack anybody who came in his way.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.